guys make square hats look great. Looking good. You can applaud for that. Well, good evening. I'm Kevin Kale, principal here at Desert Christian, and again, welcome to our commencement ceremony for the Desert Christian High School class of 2020. I will pause for your applause again. Welcome to all of you in the gym and those of you on our live stream. Hopefully it's many. We probably have some numbers there out there in cyberspace. We are glad that we could all make this happen. We're here. It's been a long time coming. There's been planning, there's been replanning, there's been guessing, and there's been second guessing, and some third guessing. This has been a year of challenges, he said as a major understatement. Difficulty and loss. Lament has been an underlying theme for months. Not coincidentally, the pastor of my church even did a 3-week series on the topic of lament just a few weeks ago. And alas, there are so many things over which to lament. The loss of an entire quarter of school. We did some online learning, but it just doesn't replace the real thing. A promising sports season, time with friends, classes with this amazing staff that you'll hear about and from later, pandemics, fires, floods, injustice, chaos, destruction, death, the list goes on. When we're experiencing loss, our holy God allows and even invites us to enter in his presence and vent to him. David demonstrates this to us time and time again in the Psalms. And of course, there's an entire book in the Old Testament entitled Lamentations. Listen to some of the words Jeremiah uses. Brace yourselves. Affliction, darkness, broken bones, bitterness, tribulation, heavy chains, crooked paths, desolation, bereft of peace, teeth grinding on gravel, my personal favorite, I guess. So great, Kevin, thanks a lot. We came to celebrate and now we're all depressed. That's not necessarily a bad place to be, because that's not the end of the story. If you've read Lamentations, hopefully you got to chapter 3. Neatly nestled there in Jeremiah's book of lament are these well-known verses. You've heard them many times, and it says this: But this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Interesting, not my lips, but my soul. Therefore I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul who seeks him. It is good that one should wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. And so, with those words, we trust in his new mercies, in something even as simple, air quotes again, as simple as a celebration like this. Class of 2020, nobody in this room knows what this year was like for you. Parents, siblings, teachers, peers, they've all walked with you through it, but nobody really knows but you. You've had the actual experience of being a high school senior during a COVID-19 pandemic. What will you do with that experience? Will you try to forget it and move on? Maybe become increasingly bitter with genuine loss? Or will your soul say, the Lord is my portion, therefore I will hope in him? Tonight we celebrate you, and we glorify our Heavenly Father in the process. So welcome.
Good evening. I'm Matthew Espenson, and I'm the student body president here at Desert Christian. Our class verse says, be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. I invite my class and everyone here to practice these words, to be completely humble and gentle, to show care for everyone that you come across and reflect Jesus's love. We love because he first loved us. And to my class, keep the unity that we have created and allow God to be the bond between us. As Michael W. Smith said, Friends are friends forever if the Lord's the Lord of them. Please join me in prayer. Lord, thank you for this amazing evening where we can all be here to celebrate this milestone in our lives. I pray that you will be with us tonight and whatever the road ahead of us will bring. Let us not forget the hardships and challenges that have shaped us into who we are today. And may our time in high school always be remembered for the difference it has made in us. We thank you for this school, for giving us the opportunity to learn, for the teachers who showed us love no matter what, for our families for supporting us in every step, and for each other and the friendships that we have made. Watch over this class and show them your grace and love. Teach us to love one another and keep us bonded in our faith to one another through you, Lord. In your name we pray. Amen.
Wow. We're finally here, guys. And it's honestly crazy how fast it went by. It seems like just yesterday we were scared little freshmen sitting in Mr. Dalton's class, terrified to read our fire drills out loud. All of us so annoyed that Sydney never got called on. Or singing Let It Go in the quad, only to absolutely crush the next 3 years of Spirit Week. Or looking up to our senior buddies and hoping that one day we would be able to meet and fulfill the incredible expectations an example that they put for us. It's so surreal to look out at all of you guys and see how much we've grown. We've become strong, confident, and courageous young men and women. Now, I know things didn't end like we expected, not even close. I mean, if you would have gone to freshman U and told you that your senior year would be canceled because of a global pandemic, the country would run out of toilet paper, and the entire mountain would be on fire, you would have called me crazy. And I know for me, these past few months have been some of the darkest and loneliest times of my life. And it's been hard not to lose sight of what's important and of who is important. When I first came to Desert, I couldn't stand the words community and feels like family. I felt like I heard it every single day, and the more I heard it, the less meaning the words had. But I think I had somewhat of a false expectation and idea of what family was. I thought that Desert was claiming to be some sort of perfect safe haven, a place where everyone would just get along and be happy. But that's not what family is. Family is messy and ugly and broken and imperfect. But despite all of the pain and heartbreak, and despite the fact that our world seems to be falling apart around us, there's just something that holds us together no matter what. And now, after all of these years, I can confidently say that I'm proud to call all of you my family. We've definitely had our ups and downs, and just like any family, we fight and we hurt each other, and we don't always get along. And as Jack likes to say, we're like a pack of wolves, and this really couldn't be more true. We are a class full of strong personalities, to say the least. And sometimes we definitely do jump on each other, and occasionally we go too far, and we end up actually hurting one another. But more than that, wolves are some of the most loving and caring and playful creatures with one another. They will protect and defend their own, no matter what, just like our class. And we are far from perfect, but when we have come together, it has been so powerful and so beautiful. And like I said, I know things didn't end like we expected. There are memories left unshared, words left unspoken, tears left unshed, and laughter kept silent. But looking out at all of you, I couldn't think of a group of young men and women more capable of overcoming something like this. We are powerful, courageous, persistent, and most of all, we are family. And I don't think that'll ever change. We knew this day would come all along, but I don't think we expected it to come so fast. Today is a day to celebrate and be proud of what we have done and who we have become, but it's also a day to remember and reflect, and a day to move forward. We're going our separate ways. A new chapter, new people, new experiences, new campuses, and perhaps even a new family. But I don't think anything will ever be quite like this, quite like our class, and quite like Desert. I think if anything, this time has shown me what it truly means to be alive. The pain, the suffering, the loneliness, and the depression, they're what make life worth living. And the brief glimpses of beauty in the darkness, they're what make everything so worth it. The moments when we come together and fight for a common cause, when we find serene comfort in our shared suffering, these things are what it means to be human. And I hope that these ideas help you find some sort of solace in this time. And as painful as it can be, God will use this to shape us into something so incredibly beautiful. And I can finally say that I'm excited to see what that will be for myself and for each and every one of you. So, with a solemn joy and a hopeful expectation for what's to come, I congratulate each and every one of you for who you have become and who you will continue to be. Thank you.
Desert Christian High School has been a blessing to the class of 2020 in the past 4 years. This place has cherished our class in all different kinds of ways. In return, we want to give this special place a gift. However, the gift itself simply just can't express how grateful we are for the school. But we do want to show our gratitude to this amazing student body and faculties. This gift is going to make student and faculty's lives more convenient at the Desert Diner, Snack Shack, or even during certain special events, once if you set it upright. So, on behalf of Class of 2020, this year we are going to give the school a Square debit card reader which comes with a brand new iPad.
Well, on behalf of the faculty and students who will follow, thank you, class of 2020, for your generosity. That's fantastic. I might have to use it.
So, Sass and I were given the honor of playing a worship song for you all, but we don't want it to be just a performance, so we would ask that you all stand with us and sing as along as well as you are able with a mask.
You go before I know that you've even gone to win my war, and you come back with the head of my enemy, and you come back and you call it my victory. Oh. seek to find your truth. Your mercy is the shade I'm living in. You restore my faith and hope again. And all I did was praise. All I did was worship. I did was bow down. Oh, all I did was stay still, stay still. Hallelujah, you have saved me. So much better your way. Hallelujah, grace better your way. Hallelujah, you have saved me. So much better your way. And hallelujah, great defender. So much better your way. So much better.
Love is patient, love is kind. It does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. I know 1 Corinthians 13 is commonly recited at weddings, not graduations. However, I find it appropriate to reflect on this for tonight. It is often said that those who love others well can replace their names with love in this passage. And while I do believe that that is a good goal to try and achieve, I think the only people on earth who have begun to even come close to living out this passage is a parent. And I think that this same love can come from grandparents or aunts and uncles who are trying to fulfill the role a parent was not able to play in a child's life. For every time we forgot our school supplies or we were fighting with our siblings, Mom was patient. And for every math problem and science project, Dad was kind. Mom, Dad, Grandma, and Grandpa do not envy our successes or boast about their own, but they hold us up so we too can accomplish great things. All too quickly, they will give up their own way and give us ours when it is good for us. They're quick to give us their ice cream cone when ours drops, or quick to make a late night trip to Walmart when we forgot the thing for our project that's due in the first thing in tomorrow morning. They do not jump at the opportunity to punish us when we disobey them, but they do it anyways because they know that it will help us grow. They do not keep a track of all of our mistakes, but instead, they forgive us and extend mercy time and time again. They celebrate with us when we meet our goals and accomplish great things. They rejoice at our successes and grieve in our mistakes alongside us. They feel all of our heartbreaks. They feel all of our disappointments, and they mourn with us at the loss of our senior year. Mom, Dad, Grandma, and Grandpa love us in all days, even when they may not love our behavior. They believe in the good in all of us, and more than that, they believe in us. They know that we, the class of 2020, will accomplish great things. Our parents and our grandparents have been our teachers from day one, teaching us to walk and talk, to ride a bike, to make friends, to share, to work hard. They taught us to be honest, to create, to do our laundry, to make friends, to drive, and to grow in our faith. In this next season of life, our parents will teach us one of the hardest lessons that we will ever learn, how to adult. However, I believe the greatest lesson that they have ever taught us is how to love. And this is the most important lesson that we can take from them moving forward into our lives. Seniors, in order to show a small token of gratitude to our parents, there is a rose under each of your chairs that you will be able to give your parents at the end of the ceremony. Let this rose be the beginning of loving as our parents loved us, and above all, as our Heavenly Father does. Mom is patient, Dad is kind. They do not envy or boast. They are not arrogant. They do not insist on their own way. They do not rejoice at our wrongdoings, but they rejoice in the truth. Mom, Dad, Grandma, and Grandpa bear all things, believe all things, hope all things, endure all things, and their love will never end. Thank you.
Okay, whose idea was it for me to go after her? That was a terrible idea. Oh my goodness. That was amazing, Sass. Thank you so much for that. Well, I know you guys are all probably hoping to hear Robert speak, but we did paper, scissor, rock, and I lost, and he wants me to speak because. But I'm happy to say that I do have a script, so I will not be rambling, even though I tend to be rambling even right now. So I'm sorry. I wanted to be remiss to say that these balloons here, which are just an incredible blessing, is Carol, Mrs. McKee's sister-in-law. It's called Say It Again with Balloons and More. So if you're looking for some balloon needs, like, that was so amazing to see that. Just another little blessing for you guys. So back to this. The Tuckers have had the privilege of being part of this class since you guys were all in kindergarten, and some of you even before. We think we can all agree that there have been some special students and special graduating classes at Desert, but we can think none as special as this one. Now, I know what you're thinking. All parents think their children are special, and we do, but we feel particularly that this collection of students has been hand-selected and equipped by Jesus to take on the challenging times that you find yourselves in the middle of today. That seems to be a general theme, obviously, is the pandemic and how strong you guys are. That's no accident, by the way. This class has been through a great many trials and tribulations together. Some of you have lost loved ones. There has been struggles that you've had to work through together, and you are persevering through chaotic times full of conflict. And if that is not enough, you are also enduring a global pandemic. The words of the great philosopher Sass Tucker, I stole this from her because she wrote this, and we couldn't find a more eloquent way to say what she did, so I'm just going to read it. The class of 2020 was robbed of many lasts, but in exchange, you were given many firsts. The first to graduate virtually due to a pandemic, the first class to finish their semester online together, the first class to resiliently unite together through social distancing. While you are not the first class to go through adversity, and you certainly will not be the last, you are the class who raised the standards of the senior year. We can think of no greater time for strong leadership in our youth, and you guys are that future. As we thought about what words to say we wanted to say tonight, pondering what we should tell this group of you guys that are about to take on the world, we could think of no greater wisdom that the words have been given to us by our Lord and Savior in Matthew 22, 37 through 39, when questioned by his disciples about the greatest commandment. Jesus replied, again with the theme, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all of your soul and with all of your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment, and the second is like it. Love your neighbors as yourself. As you enter into a world of great conflict, it is that you just live out that command. Our prayer is that you can love in truth. There are many people on the left, people on the right, people on all sides of a great many issues facing our world today. Jesus isn't a Democrat. Jesus isn't a Republican. There is no absolute truth in the media or political affiliations. The only real truth is in Jesus. You have been called to live that truth and spread that truth in love, and we pray that you can live your life with that goal in mind. To finish off this year in the tradition of Ray Phillips, we are here to give...
I can't read it. Deep Thoughts with Jack Handy.
Before you criticize someone, you should walk a mile in their shoes. That way, when you do criticize them, you are a mile away from them and you have their shoes.
Well, good evening. It has been my pleasure to serve as your interim executive director this year, and particularly fun tonight as I've had three of my own graduates come through Desert, and one of our fondest memories is the blessing. So just a few words, if this is your first time in a DCS graduation, let me just give you a little background on why we do the blessing. It is one of our most distinctive and special ceremonies at Desert. We've done it since the inception of graduations, and it harkens back to blessings in the Old Testament. If you've read Genesis, you've seen a pattern from Abraham to Isaac to Jacob, even many centuries later into Moses and his brother Aaron, where they give a blessing. We know that words are powerful, they can be healing, and they can also be destructive. Tonight's our opportunity to pour into these graduates. These young men and women have blessed us, and it's now our turn to bless them. We've lived life on campus. We've seen their walk. We've seen them grow over the years. We know things about them that you don't know, parents. And some things we'll keep secret, okay? One thing I want you to remember tonight, graduates, is that these words are meant just for you. They're meant to be words of life and words of hope. One of the most powerful examples of this is found in Matthew 16, where Peter is asked by Jesus, who do you say I am? And Simon Peter answered, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And Jesus replied to Peter, "Blessed are you, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but this was revealed by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you, Peter, I will build my church. You are the rock, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it." Peter needed these words. These were sticky words. They would stick to him like glue as he went in to lead the church after the crucifixion of our Lord. He needed to know that the Lord saw something in him, saw that he was the rock. He was going to be unshakable. So our hope tonight is that as you hear the blessings from our staff and faculty, that these words will be long remembered. The verses that they share and the words that they share with you, we pray that they'll lift you up. Parents, I encourage you to sit back and savor this moment. These are wonderful young people, and they're about to be blessed.
Mrs. Acosta could not be here tonight, so I have the privilege of reading her blessings to the next two young men. Zachary, come on up. Now you have to imagine Mrs. Acosta saying these things to you, okay? Hi, Zachary. When you first joined us, we couldn't believe how shy and unassuming you were. It wasn't until we saw you devouring donuts and pizza that we discovered you were actually a gremlin in disguise. Miss Lanning and I were very happy watching your confidence grow. When I read Douglas McKelvey's Literature for Students and Scholars, I found inspiration for blessing you. Part of a prayer said, "Open, O Lord, as you will, the paths of my life in days to come. Use my studies to further shape my vision of what my place and call in this world might be." Those lines also guided me to the verse I have chosen for you, Ephesians 3:20. With God's power working in us, God can do much, much more than anything we can ask or imagine. Zach, the gifts you have to share and the possibilities to touch others' lives are blessings in themselves. My prayers will be with you as you discover new talents and who you are in the grand scheme of things. I'm very proud of your accomplishments and excited to see the plans God has for you. Thank you also for blessing me with happy memories. Congratulations, Zach. And Landon. Hi, Landon. In the time we shared here at Desert, I have enjoyed your kind and inquisitive nature. I'm also glad that the treats and occasional naps helped. Whether discussing apologetics or current events, your insights were a pleasure to hear. Watching you give your testimony in chapel and your father's pride was exciting. Your appreciation for the military and hopes in joining the Marines reminded me of your desire to serve. The verse I chose for you is found in the book of Job. In chapter 32, Job's friend speaks with determination of the spirit in man. That led me to your verse, Job 33:4. The Spirit of God created me, and the breath of God, all-powerful, gave me life. And in further reading, I found a portion of a prayer for you. God grant this child knowledge and understanding. Lead me to the truth. God bless this new season. Shape me for your service. There is much to experience in the world, and I hope you enjoy the adventures. By remembering whose child you are, you will never be alone. Trust that he will use those experiences to guide and prepare you for your purpose. I'm very proud of you. Congratulations, Landon. And I have the honor of blessing this young man And you do not have to imagine Mrs. Acosta's voice anymore. Okay. Peter, when I first met you in my classroom 3 years ago, you were a different person. God has been at work in your life. He is a God of transformation, and that is evident to those who have known you for a while. I have many fond memories with you, Peter. Some of those include hanging 7 extra clocks in my classroom, getting a hug from author-speaker Bob Goff, and sharing our own inside jokes during class. But my favorite memory has to be when you asked me to baptize you in the Jordan River on our trip to Israel. That was a life-defining moment for both of us, and I thank you for your trust in asking me. This verse is simple, yet profound, so that's one of the reasons it made me think of you. The book of Micah, chapter 6, starts by saying, "Listen to what the Lord says." Micah goes on to give very clear and succinct instructions as to how he wants you to live in verse 8. This is the verse I'm choosing for you. He says, "He has shown you, O man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? To act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. Doing justice toward other people requires you to love mercy, which necessitates walking humbly with God. The next time you are faced with a major decision and you aren't sure what to do, remember this is what God instructs. Don't overcomplicate things as you walk his path. Peter, I'm honored to bless you. I'm thankful for the transparency in our friendship, and I'm excited to see where God leads you. Congratulations."
All right, keep it together. Mercy, the verse I share with you is Thessalonians 4:1. I'm going to say it very slow because it's a tongue twister. "Finally then, brethren, we request and exhort you in the Lord Jesus that as you receive from us instruction as how to you ought to walk and please God, just as you actually walk, that you excel still more." Paul implores the Thessalonians to walk and lead a life that pleases God. Paul's message here was meant to both encourage and motivate. I would like to do the same for you. The Christian life is not a single step which instantly brings a believer to spiritual maturity. Rather, it's a lifelong exercise of grace, devotion, and faithfulness. It is my prayer that you desire to become more Christ-like, growing in your commitment to walk a path pleasing to God. Mercy, I encourage you to use your God-given gifts for his glory. Take risk, step out of your comfort zone, be a blessing. It has been a pleasure walking through these past few years with you. I have watched you grow considerably in the classroom, on the court, and in daily life. I know that I would like to challenge you as my mentor challenged me so many years ago to excel still more. I love you, and God bless you. Sorry, wasn't supposed to do that. I know. The verse I have chosen for you, Dan, is John 14:27. "I am leaving you with a gift, peace of mind and heart, and the peace I give is a gift the world cannot give you. So don't be troubled or afraid." Nearly 4 years ago, a spirited, and I do mean spirited, young man walked into basketball practice, and I dare say that both of our lives changed significantly that day. You have become a second son to me, and for that, I am eternally grateful. I have watched you grow and mature, but mostly, I have seen your heart soften. Don't worry, I won't tell anyone about that. As you have experienced the peace of mind and heart that only the Lord can provide, the very same Christ that calmed the storms for his disciples has calmed your storm that rages in you. As you enter the next stage of life, keep this verse close to your heart. It is not insignificant that the Lord shares his very own peace with us. The Lord desires to have a personal relationship with you. Remember, this world will never be able to provide you with the gift of peace. Only the Lord can do that. Do not be troubled. Do not be afraid. May the Lord guide you, your steps as you begin your next new adventure. I love you truly, Day and Magic.
Yes, sir. Wait. That's cool.
Much better. My dear Jack, who knew 4 years ago when I watched this round-cheeked little blonde boy with soccer mom earbuds run across the grass during lunch or sit patiently in the lobby after school that we would get to stand here today side by side at your graduation? You have been called several names throughout your years here at Desert. LJ, Cake Boy, someone's boyfriend, and more recently a special sparkler. And while those names aren't wrong or untrue, here is what you are truly called: worthy, loved, wanted, and God's son. Over 4 years, you have gone from boy to man. Your desire to serve, provide, and lead is evident from your position on the soccer field, to your role in student council, to the way you care for the least of these and have loved those who have needed it most. From our conversations on advanced bio, sitting in awe on the back of a boat looking at the glory of what God has created, or diving deep into our souls on salt, or long afternoon talks during quarantine, you have impacted my life and taught me how to be more gracious, caring, and compassionate. I know I am not alone in saying that you inspire the people around you to be better people, and you have left a beautiful mark on many hearts. Things have not always been easy for you, and while it is always a joy to watch the happiness and triumphs in your life, it has been equally amazing to watch and hear of your struggles, because it was and is in those moments when your light shines brightest and your passion for the world around you and ultimately your Savior is most evident. The verse I have chosen for you is my personal favorite verse. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, for I have overcome the world. John 16:33. No matter where you go, Jack, no matter what life brings you, never stop giving it your all. Never stop caring for those who are hard to care for. Never stop reveling in the beauty of what God has created, and never, ever forget that you are worthy, that you are loved, and that you are wanted by the Creator of all and by me. Love you always, Jack.
Thank you so much.
Sorry. All right. Wise words from Anna Murray. The most valuable things are love, loyalty, and friendship. You know the true meaning of Ohana. Ohana means family, and family means that nobody gets left behind or forgotten. Pardon me, I just quoted a movie, but that's okay. Anna, I've watched you as we have started our school mornings together, and I've seen your daily impact on our homeroom family. Those small touch points on others, a dedication to leaving no one behind. And Psalm 68:6 talks about how God places the lonely in families. He sets the desolate free, and he gives them joy. And you, Anna, you teamed up to cultivate a safe little morning family where sweet, scared, lonely, beautiful humans can find joy. And God knew that to be true, and trusted it to be consistently true. You care deeply. You do. Yet your cultivation of love, loyalty, and friendship is not exclusive to being a proud stinky cheese man. It is found everywhere. It's found on stage, in your nuclear family, and perhaps best when you lead worship. I'm stealing from Mrs. Fodor yesterday, that twinkle in your eye. I mean, it's even happening right now. Verse 4 of Psalm 68 is so you. Sing praises to God and to his name. Sing loud praises to him who rides through the desert. His name is the Lord, and rejoice in his presence. You have led the way for the desolate. That is us. To God's hope, inspiring us, moving us to declare joy, even in the midst of suffering. You're not perfect. No one is. So endeavor to carry on in the most valuable things of love, loyalty, and friendship as our redemptive Father seeks genuine people like you to gather the lost to himself. I love you very much. I love you. All right, you take a half a step closer. You're gonna, yeah, there you go. All right, wise words from Sarah Swinney. Everything and everyone has a story. You said that. You probably don't remember it. You spoke those words on the road to the Mount of Beatitudes after I asked you what your top learning was so far in our trip to Israel. You said, God wrote a story and we are a part of that story. We are walking in and hearing those stories. And to be a part of them with my story is pretty amazing. And soon after, at the top of that very hill, our guide reminded us that the Beatitudes are about hard times and what to do and how to live. And in that surreal moment, I can still picture it today, in that surreal moment, I was witnessing God weave your story into the kingdom. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. And the Message paraphrases it this way. You're blessed when you feel you've lost what is most dear to you. Only then can you be embraced by the one most dear to you. John Bunyan, author of The Pilgrim's Progress, essentially wrote, to have a needy heart is to God an excellent thing. And so at its best, the sign of true strength is humility and the authentic recognition of one's own brokenness, for that is where we truly understand our need for God. You, Sarah, are a strong woman, good enough just as you are. Your story is one of strength, wisdom, and dignity, ready to be intertwined with whomever is in front of you, and your story is indeed blessed. More than just with happiness, but with the enviable state of one who is in God's kingdom. I love you very much. You're welcome.
Well, I am not Pastor Kyle. He's not able to be here this evening, but I'm honored to bless Lily Tace. These are Pastor Kyle's words. Lily, I have been so blessed by your faithful and cheerful service as my teacher's aide for Freshman Bible for 2 years. Knowing you're headed to NAU to major in special education, I have three specific blessings for you. One, that God would continue to bless you with his compassion for the least of these among us. Two, that God would give you wisdom as you study, learn, and grow, and greater understanding about teaching and ministering to those with special needs. And three, to all those who you get to meet along the way, to see the love of Jesus pouring from within your soul and your spirit. The verse I prayerfully chose for you is Isaiah 26, 3 and 4, which says, "You, Lord, will keep in your perfect peace all who trust in you, all whose thoughts are fixed in you. Trust in the Lord always. For the Lord God is the eternal rock." Lily, congratulations.
Oh, going on this side. Ashlyn, I'm going to cry before I even start. Bear with me here. Freshman study hall. That's where it all began. Not a whole lot of studying got done there, but a whole lot of relationship building, trust building, and a lot of laughter and goofiness. You quickly bulldozed your way into my heart. And as you let me into yours and allowed me to encourage you and be a part of your life, through the highs and lows of the past 4 years, you have blessed me more than you'll ever know. You have the gift of encouragement and such a tender and grateful heart. Your thoughtful notes and hugs always come at the right time when I need encouragement. And something that I cherished about you from the very beginning was your ability for transparency. You're someone who's not afraid to express emotion and reach out. This is something that, as Christians, many times we're not able to do well because we hold our hurt inside, thinking that we have to have it all together. But you, Ashlyn, you have been a beautiful example to me of something that I need to learn better with transparency and vulnerability. So as physical distance increases from people at Desert, to whom you have often gone for help and wisdom, although we're still only a text and a phone call away, it becomes increasingly important that you transfer that to your Heavenly Father, who loves you more than any of us ever could, and he will always be with you when we can't be. So the verse that I chose for you, Ashlyn, is this is God speaking to you through Isaiah in 41:10. It says, "Don't be afraid, because I am with you. Don't be intimidated. I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. And I will support you with my victorious right hand." I bless you, dear Ashlyn. I am so proud of you, and I love you with all of my heart. Okay, I also get to bless Avery. Hey, Avery, we first met when you were in seventh grade, when our family first came to Desert. And I had so much fun getting to know you through Missions Week, 7th and 8th grade trips, and subbing for your classes. Coincidentally, the freshman social hour, study hall, we also got to spend time getting to know each other better over jalapeno Cheeto Puffs. I was so grateful later to have you as my teacher's aide, cutting endless bellwork cards and grading stacks of quizzes. And I have loved seeing you grow in your confidence. In Spanish class, I saw you overcome your fear of speaking in front of people. And then a couple of years later, I stood in awe as you eloquently defended your faith in apologetics class in front of your class, other teachers, and administrators. I have seen you grow as a steady and faithful young man with inner strength that is fueled by your love for God and your compassion for others. So the verse that I've chosen for you is Jeremiah 17, 7 through 8. "Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord, whose trust is the Lord. He is like a tree planted by the water that sends out its roots by the stream and does not fear when the heat comes. For its leaves remain green, and it is not anxious in the year of drought, for it does not cease to bear fruit." When I chose this verse, I pictured your feet firmly planted each time you took a charge on the basketball court, and whether or not the ref called the charge, you got up and continued to play your heart out. So stay rooted in your trust in the Lord, Avery, and stay steadfast when trials and difficulties come, and I look forward to seeing the amazing fruit that comes from your life. I love you, and I bless you.
You demonstrate so much maturity in your young age. You're truly kind and beautiful in every way. You possess a strength that is both graceful and passionate. I can see God's glory through your actions and words here at Desert. He has given you such talent and leadership ability. Throughout the volleyball season, you demonstrated passion and perseverance for your team and for your school. You prayed so effortlessly and genuinely for the team. Through you, God was shining bright. You brought your passion to class each day as you shared your thoughts and selflessly helped others. You did so with joy and enthusiasm. You would ask questions that showed a true search for learning and understanding. God loves you. He has given you the strength to lead and inspire. You are humble and don't realize the great impact you have. The verse that I have chosen for you is 1 Timothy 4:12. Don't let anyone look down on you because you are young, but set an example for the believers in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, and in purity. You are a true child of God. You demonstrate your faith so purely and so effortlessly. You inspire others through your words and in your actions. I pray that you continue to be the salt and the light as you go out into the world. You will show others how glorious our God is. I love you, and I'm so proud of all you have accomplished and will accomplish. Mark, we have spent a great deal of time together this year. Homeroom, second hour economics, third hour statistics, fifth hour psychology, and sometimes seventh hour snacking and reflecting. I have watched God work in your life. Excuse me. You have such a kind spirit, always offering a smile and a hello. You have an inner joy and brightness. God has given you the strength to overcome obstacles. Small obstacles, such as falling in class in a variety of ways. Greater obstacles that have helped you grow. Great adventure awaits you. I have no doubt that you will approach the next chapter of your life with joy and enthusiasm. I am confident that God has great things in store for you. I know that you will approach life with passion and will show others the love of God has placed in your heart. I smile, knowing you will share your gifts and talents with our world. You will make our world a better place. That I have chosen the following verse for you, Isaiah 40:29-31. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. You have an inner strength that is apparent in all that you do. God will walk with you through your future education and beyond. He will be with you and provide you strength. I love you and I will miss you.
Raceland? I love those who can smile in trouble, who can gather strength from distress, and grow brave by reflection. 'Tis the business of little minds to shrink, but they whose heart is firm and whose conscience approves their conduct will pursue their principles unto death. Leonardo da Vinci. Graceland, from the first day in drama class, I took notice of you. Deceptively quiet in class, but I sensed a great depth of talent and emotion in you. I watched you, and I waited to see the moments when you would let yourself go, which you did, in time, in class, in musical theater, and at our Shakespeare competitions. Well done, by the way. But always, you let go in a patient and humble way, almost as if you didn't want to trouble anyone. Precious lady, you have so much talent inside of you that my prayer for you is to let go and let God flourish in your life. My prayer is for you to live in wild abandon in all that God lays before you in the time to come. Yes, I want you to make a joyful noise. I want you to be seen and heard and praised for all that you are. Your inner reflective beauty
your outer grace, your charm, your sweetness, your strength of character, and sheer loveliness to behold. Don't hide your light under a bushel, no. I pray for you never to feel discouraged without allowing that feeling to move you to something better that our Lord has planned all along for you. Trust in his goodness and dance freely in the days to come. Bless you, dear woman, as you take the next steps of your journey. Grow boldly into the woman who knows who she is and whom it is she serves. The Lord himself goes before you and will be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. Deuteronomy 31:8. Happy graduation a month or so late. And when I know you are safe, I owe you one great big hug. Oh my goodness, I gotta look at that. I just love you. All right, Justin. Unless the theater can ennoble you, make you a better person, you should flee from it. Konstantin Stanislavski. Justin, this is a terrifying and magnificent call to the artist from Stanislavski. Allow theater to ennoble you or flee from it. I have witnessed firsthand how it has ennobled you, dear man. You have been my dream student, truly the first that I have taught that has hungered after the art and responded to the call. I am overwhelmed with joy in who you are as a man and who you have become as the artist. Your accomplishments are worthy and of value. I know it has not been easy. I know there are days coming that will be harder for you, and I'm sorry in advance for them. But if anyone can take the hardships and persevere through them to the better end, it is you. My prayer is that you will not shoulder the times ahead alone, but trust in God and cast your worries onto him who is more than capable of sustaining you and ushering you into his perfect plan. I pray that your tender, kind, and loving spirit will be protected from hardness. I pray that you will be surrounded by friends that love and uplift you in the arts. I pray that your mind will be continually transformed by the Holy Spirit as you learn your craft. Lastly, I pray for you to find peace in Christ as you journey forward, knowing that you are loved deeply, passionately, and eternally by the omnipresent Father that created you. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Romans 15:13. Happy graduation, and I will see you by the pond whenever you want. And yes, you too, right now, a virtual big fat hug, okay? Okay.
The student whom we are blessing couldn't be with us tonight, but we have it on good authority that he's watching this live stream, so it's our privilege to bless Corbin Gonzalez.
Corbin, you are a man of integrity who is full of a joy that you are willing to share with everyone through your contagious smile and strong hugs.
Everything you've accomplished, so you've accomplished a whole lot by becoming a pilot, guys. He's a pilot. That's kind of scary, huh? Before finishing high school, he became a pilot, and he chose to take an interest and listen to those around him instead of focusing on himself. Corbin, you are truly thoughtful and compassionate.
It is the prayer of your campus mom and dad that you continue to be a man of God who puts others first and is a beacon of light in darkness.
The verse that we chose for you is Proverbs 31, verses 8 and 9. Speak up for those who cannot speak for themselves, for the rights of all who are destitute. Speak up and judge fairly. Defend the rights of the poor and needy.
Corbin, even though we won't be seeing you every day, please know that you will always be in our prayers and you will always be part of our family. We love you.
So hard not to be able to hug you while we're doing this, but Tal, I'm so proud of you. So here is your blessing. Since you arrived as a young woman from Vietnam, I've begun to know you as a strong and vibrant force here at school. You work hard to accomplish goals, and now you're planning a future in business, and you have many other plans as well. I've counted you as a friend and cherish many memories of times of joy together. Much of it involving Vietnamese food, or working on projects, or paintings, or something else for musical theater, of course, because the sets needed us. I praise the Lord for one wonderful fact. It's that you know him, you trust in his goodness, and will grow in this knowledge as you walk with Jesus. I chose this verse from Ephesians 3 because it's perfect for you now as you graduate from Desert. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power, together with all the saints, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know that this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of the Lord. Ephesians 3:17. I love you. I've cherished your time here at Desert. I'm proud of you. And I will miss you. We'll have a hug in the future. Hey, Ray. Oh, are you going to stand there? Okay, great. I'll just move over. Ray, it's good to see you here up on the stage. You've grown a lot through your time here at Desert. So, Ray, you came here from China as a sophomore. You had come to spend a little bit of time with us. And then because you liked us, you decided to come back and stay with us for a long time. You decided to come to our school, to be part of our community. And here, I hope you know that you are loved, and you're loved by your family, each of your friends, your teachers here at Desert, and also by the powerful, loving Father who created the world and everything in it. Our Creator Father has a Son, Jesus Christ, who paid with his earthly life and blood in order to give us unending life in himself. He is the way, the truth, and the life. I pray that God fills you with faith, that he awakens your mind and spirit to know him. As a believer, knowing Jesus brings me wonderful hope, personal worth, and feeling that the purposes set for me are true and right as I trust in him. I pray that you will trust in Jesus with all your heart. And I'm very proud of you. Your father has chosen for you to go to Michigan State University. It's cold up there, but it's really beautiful. It's a good trade-off. God has wonderful purposes and plans for you, and he will continue to open your eyes to them so that you'll discover what those are. And we will remember here, you here at Desert. I'll miss you very much.
I got to look at the picture. Oh my goodness, so cute. So I'm going off script just a little bit here, but I do have to say that I've been through a lot of the same struggles that you've gone through. And in the time of my sorrow, I wanted to know why God was allowing me to go through that. And I walked away from the first meeting that I had with you and your parents over in the teacher's lounge a couple summers ago, and I realized why the Lord had allowed me to go through that, and it was so that I could connect with someone as wonderful as you. So, Kenan, over the last 2 years, I have had the honor of watching you grow, develop, and develop into the warrior God is calling you to be. When people hear the word warrior, they often define it narrowly and only imagine an in-your-face and aggressive type of person. But this isn't your way. Your warrior spirit is defined by the power of your introspection. You think and feel deeply about the world around you. You have dealt with difficulty and pain so much more than many people realize, and this can oftentimes feel like a solitary island. I've seen you struggle, frustrated, felt persecuted, and struck down emotionally and physically, but you didn't ever stay there. You used the gift you have been given to process what you were going through and allowed the Lord's truth to draw you off the island. Your trials are not over. You will have more. But my prayer for you is that you embrace these trials because God uses them as the roadmap to your life's calling and purpose. Don't allow the lies of the enemy to suck you back onto the island. God desires for you to connect with the others going through similar struggles and give the hope of Jesus. It's in this way that you fulfill the verse I've chosen for you. It's from 2 Corinthians 4:8-9. In every way we are troubled but not crushed, frustrated but not in despair, persecuted but not abandoned, and struck down but not destroyed. I will sincerely miss you, and this place will not be the same without you. I love you. Thank you. Oh, isn't she beautiful, you guys? Hallie, I'm not usually a crier, so. The verse I've chosen for you is from 1 Peter 3:4. But let your adorning be the hidden person of the heart with the imperishable beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which in God's sight is very precious. When faced with the difficult realization that your head injury forever changed who you had always known yourself to be, you still found a way to find joy. It would have been so easy to stay in a place of mourning and shut out the world around you. You could have focused on the things of this world that had been taken from you, but instead you clung tighter to Jesus and looked to him to define your identity. And this is what he said. You are royalty. You have the heart and mind of a princess of the kingdom of heaven. Jesus isn't about the things this world tells us are important. He is going after your heart, and yours, Hallie, is beautiful. You have a way of speaking without saying a word. You are not loud or boastful, but quiet and gentle. Your mere presence can bring peace in the midst of chaos and joy in the midst of sorrow. You care about people the way Jesus does. Having this kind of gift can sometimes be exhausting in a world that is constantly telling you to think of yourself and not of others. I pray that you find refreshment and rejuvenation in the Lord daily because the world needs people like you, Hallie. We need you to remind us of the love that Jesus has for his people. I love you.
Oh, nice. That is awesome. Matthew Espenson, it's been a joy to see you grow over these 4 years. One of my first memories of you was in a musical audition. You sang, your voice cracked. Mrs. Fodor commented that in a year you'd be ready. She was right. You have grown into a godly young man with amazing talent in music, acting, leadership, and so much more. My verse for you is from 1 Timothy, and it's chapter 6, verse 12. Fight the good fight of faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called. and about which you were made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. I've been rereading The Lord of the Rings this summer, sort of summer. I've been struck by the fight, the perseverance, the fortitude of Frodo and Sam as they press toward their goal to rid themselves of all that encumbered them. It's even more intense in the book, by the way. That's my prayer for you. There will be challenges, but you've been called for a purpose. Continue to take hold of that purpose. Continue to press on to that for which you were called. And this cloud of witnesses will cheer you on every step of the way. Love you, man. All right, Cody, come on down. Oh, that's a good picture. You know that was coming. Cody, you've had difficulties. You've had challenges. You've had traumas. And if you're human, and I believe that you are, you have shed some tears. My encouragement to you is to never apologize for that. Never apologize for getting emotional at the loss of someone dear to you. God has given us emotions to express how we feel. As men, we often cave to cultural and societal pressure and stuff those emotions. But Jesus himself wept. He was a man acquainted with grief. And so you're in the best of company. My verse for you is one that had particular significance for me. When my dad died 6.5 years ago. I'm not saying sorry. Psalm 56:8. You've kept count of my tossings and put my tears in your bottle. Are they not in your book? And when the time of grief is done and grief does end, sometimes it comes back. I can't see now. Thank God for the relationships, both with a person dear to you and with him. Cody, I love you.
Some of you may have noticed that I'm not a small, slender Indian woman. But I think I could pull it off if I had to, okay? So from the inspiration of Jesus to the words of Ratna to the voice of Giannis. Feel the love, David Kirkpatrick Fagan. All right, that's straight out of the heart of Boston or something, okay. And the Lord's servant must not be quarrelsome, but must be kind to everyone, able to teach, not resentful. Opponents must be gently instructed in the hope that God will grant them repentance, leading them to a knowledge of the truth. 2 Timothy 2, verses 24 and 25. David, I notice that the choice to be humble is something that comes naturally from within you, and you have always amazed me with your kind spirit. You excel in many things, whether it is academics or community service, but you never show any pride. Rather, you promote others above yourself. You always show respect, which is a trait that will serve you well in life. Success is not about your accomplishments, it's about the difference you make in people's lives. My prayer for you in the future is to cultivate these qualities of humility and respect. You also have such a brave and truthful personality, and my prayer for you in the future is that you will meet life honestly and courageously. Whatever struggles you may face in life, never fear, for the Lord is always with you. He will strengthen you and uphold you with his righteous hand. May God's grace always be with you, and continue to trust in him in all that you do. We both love you.
I want to read to you guys a note that I got from Sass when she was in the third grade. Mrs. McKee, I just wanted to let you know that you are officially invited to my graduation, if you are still alive. This is the original note. Alex, Alexandra Elizabeth Tucker, the verse I have chosen for you is 1 Corinthians 13:4 through 6. Love is patient, love is kind. It does not envy, it does not boast. It is not proud, it does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with truth. Sass, this scripture describes you perfectly. You are very much admired for your good character. You display these virtues to everyone around you, myself included. I've seen you give love in which the happiness of another person is essential to your own. I've seen you practice patience throughout your high school years, even as you've gone through your own trials. You learn to use each challenge as an opportunity and to overcome each problem despite adversity. You are a person who trusts the Lord God in all you do, and because you show strength as you trust in Him, your family and friends know that you are a trustworthy person. As a trusting person, you are not afraid to do new challenges. As you venture into your new phase of life, I pray that you continue to draw from God's never-ending promises, that your faith will continue to grow, to use the gifts God gave to you to change the world, and that God will use your love to continue to bless many lives in the years ahead. I love you.
Dearest Greta, we have spoken together often about this journey of ours, this journey of desire to know God and be apprehended by Him. In his spiritual autobiography, Surprised by Joy, C.S. Lewis calls this overwhelming desire for God joy. Lewis says, to want it is to have it, and to have it is to want more of it. It is this quality that I most see and love in you, Greta. You want more than anything else to know God and be known by Him. This desire is as important to your being as water is to life. You long for fellowship with the living God, and it is the essence of your gentle and loving character. You are as beautiful and as graceful as a deer, and this is my blessing to you. As the deer pants for the streams of water, so my soul pants for you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. Psalm 42, 1 through 2. I love you, Greta. Oh, look at my goodness. My precious Autumn. I have known you since you were a wee child playing Little Eponine in Desert's production of Les Miserables. There are so many longed-for opportunities in life, and inevitably there is despair when what we hope for does not materialize. Scripture tells us in Proverbs 13:12, a hope deferred makes the heart sick, but a longing fulfilled is a tree of life. Autumn, I have watched you weather many disappointments here, and I have seen your emotional and spiritual growth throughout. I have witnessed God's workmanship in you as you have chosen the better portion of desire. This is why I want to speak this blessing over you from Psalm 73, 25 to 26. This is a personal scripture of mine. Whom have I in heaven but you? And on earth, there is nothing I desire besides you. My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart
and my portion forever. I love you so much.
Hey, Ryan. Hi. Ryan, Isaiah 58:10 through 11. If you spend yourselves on behalf of the hungry and satisfy the needs of the oppressed, then your light will rise in darkness. The Lord will guide you always. He will satisfy your needs in a sun-scorched land and will strengthen your frame. Ryan, you remind me of myself. You're a highly intelligent, brilliant at problem solving. You desire to know the right answers. However, if there's one way in which we're both similar, it's this. We both have a strong reliance on ourselves. This can prevent us from helping others and truly letting God lead our ways. The paradox of pouring out ourselves so that God can pour into us is daunting. But if we give to others on their behalf rather than for our benefit, that's where God meets you and provides true sustenance. It's difficult to truly let God be our guide, and it's not going to happen all at once. But God is telling you, Ryan, I will take care of you. I will make you stronger. I will satisfy you. I will nurture you. I will guide you. Ryan, my prayer for you is that you will look upon God's people, especially those who are hurting, oppressed, and neglected, and help them for their sake, not asking for anything in return. And I believe he has gifted you with the ability to connect with others and hear them well. I pray for you specifically that as you go into college, that you love others well, and rest in the comfort that the Lord God will be your guide and satisfy you fully. Props. That is an awesome picture. He still looks like that too. Adam, Isaiah 66:2. These are the ones I look on with favor, those who are humble and contrite in spirit and who tremble at my word. Adam, I'm going to say it frankly, you're a geek. You love pouring into your interests with such zeal. There's a bit of tension, though, sometimes between our interest and being a follower of Jesus. We can sometimes get sucked into our interests without regard to our relationship with God. Our focus is no longer on him and other people, but rather on ourselves and our need to be the very best like no one ever was. Adam, God looks at you and he marvels at you and he finds favor with you. You aren't perfect, but you are a person who is humble before others, who is willing to place the needs of other people before yourself, and who strives to do the right thing. My prayer for you is that God will continue to be your ultimate satisfaction and that you will find your identity is not simply just based on your interest, but rather on the fact that you were created in the image of God. God has given you talents and skills and interests that are for his purpose for reaching others in your life for his glory. Be cautious that you're not trying to integrate God into your interest, but rather give your interest to God and let him be in control of the direction that you take. Be confident, Adam. God is preparing you for amazing things, but continue to be humble. Allow yourself to feel the prompting of the Holy Spirit and turn to the Word of God to give you life. He will use you and your interest to fulfill his plan. Congratulations.
Dear Jaslyn, from the first time I met you as a freshman math student, I have loved your name, Jaslyn. I thought it sounded really cool and fit you perfectly. However, having looked up its meaning, God is gracious, while preparing your blessing, I see that it fits you at a much deeper level as well. It has been wonderful to watch you grow from your first day as a shy freshman into such a confident young woman who can light up a room with her happy spirit and 100-watt smile. I have watched how you, along with your fellow seniors, helped make our homeroom a safe place to share, especially at this year's retreat. I also admire the confidence you have to be yourself, whether through your voiced opinions or your fun and creative sense of style. I want to let you know how your senior blessing to me was such a gift. Your kind words were so encouraging and truly touched my heart. No one will be surprised that the blessing verse I chose for you is about joy. In John 15:11, Jesus says, "I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete." Simple happiness is great, but my prayer is that you will seek and find that unshakable joy that doesn't depend on the circumstances around you. I will be praying that you will find this joy as you start the next chapter of your life with God. Love you. Dear Hannah, I am so glad that you decided to become a part of DCHS for your junior and senior years. It probably wasn't easy, but your kindness, maturity, commitment to excellence, and warm smile have made you a vital part of our community. Also, what would I have done without at least one other female in physics? I love your willingness to try new things, like taking care of the Wrightstown campus farm for your senior expo, even when animal husbandry may not be your first love. Also, your amazing Shakespeare monologue performance and joining the mock trial team for the first time as a senior really impressed me. I also can't tell you how much that surprise gift of flowers and your encouraging note meant during that very stressful time of online teaching. Oh, that meant the world to me. I am not sure how this last few months have changed the goals that you wrote at the beginning of second semester. January seems like forever ago. But they made me think of this blessing verse from Daniel 12:5 for you. Those who are wise will shine like the brightness of the heavens, and those who lead many to righteousness like the stars forever. Although college will probably look a little different, I know that if you take that next step of faith, trusting God to make you the amazing woman that he planned for you to be, even before you were born, it will lead you to the deep joy you seek. And please know I will be praying for you.
Dear Amelia, Galatians 6:10 says, "Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, especially those who belong to the family of believers. For your blessing, I think it would be best to break down this verse into three sections so you understand how it applies to you. One, as we have opportunity. Some people must be reminded to make the most of each day, but you understand that life is short. You take time to stop and smell the roses, to seek out the beautiful and embrace the unusual. The familiar is what grounds you, but the unfamiliar is where you laugh and learn and play. Like, for example, if I asked you to sing a song about slimy meat sandwiches right now with me, would you? Yeah, that's what I mean. Two. Let us do good to all people. Very few people will remain professional and polite when all others are rude and obnoxious. But this is something that comes naturally to you. It's your nature to listen rather than to be the first to speak. You make loving the unlovable look easy. It's your unconditional smile that tears down brick walls and your indiscriminate hugs that keeps these walls down. By reaching out to people, you bring other people in. Three. Especially to those who belong to the family of believers. As opportunities present themselves, you do good to all, especially brothers and sisters in Christ. Often we think of this kind of help as missionary work, and you've done that too. But it's the good that you do for God's kingdom in our own backyard that I've been a witness to. And I could say so many, but I don't have time at this podium. But perhaps the most important good that I've watched you do for God's kingdom is when you're quiet and you let him take control of especially difficult situations. Like, for example, when a friend hurts you, you don't retaliate. Or when relationships fall apart, you don't take sides. If an adult is unfair, you listen. So these are all reasons why Galatians 6:10, enduring words written before your time, properly describes your spirit. May God never forget, and that you use it to his glory. Oh, these masks are good for more than one thing. Okay. Dear Henry, everyone here knows that you're a quiet, private person. Am I right? Few are allowed into your world of trucks, guns, political opinions. It took quite a while, but at some point over the last few years, you decided that I was someone you would allow in. And I consider that to be the real blessing that I'm sharing with everyone here tonight. I'm supposed to be blessing you, but actually you bless me and have for a long time. It's such an honor when I get to have one-on-one conversations with you about things that we think is best for our country, or if we're just making fun of Chevys, or people that we think are idiots. But even the people that don't know you the way that I do are still blessed to have met Henry Yates. Your very presence impacts people positively. We all need a quiet role model, someone who cannot be someone who cannot be swayed in their rooted beliefs, someone who stands up for what's right regardless of the cost, someone who's loyal and trustworthy, and someone who can keep secrets. You exhibit these character traits naturally, while the rest of us, this takes years to develop, if ever. But because of this, you will be attacked out of jealousy. Because you're quiet, people will try to talk over you or at you. You will listen to others, but because you won't give in to every societal whim, many will hate you. As such, remember Ephesians 6:12 when you come up against those who want to tear you down. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. It isn't one political party that is the enemy. It isn't one ideology or another, one leader, one authority. Our struggle isn't against each other, but it's against the enemy who influences others and wants us to tear each other apart. As I've said before, remember that we are living in the enemy's camp, and it will take firmly rooted Christian men like you and Ford trucks to help us navigate this dangerous terrain. I love you so much.
Emily, one of the things I appreciate most about you is the way you see people with compassion and empathy. When others suffer, you suffer. Then you turn it into action. I have seen you go to battle. When there is injustice, unkindness, or doubt, you rise to the challenge. You do not shrink away. I've seen you speak your mind with honesty and passion. The world needs more passionate pursuers of justice like you. I pray this verse for you. 2 Timothy 1:7, for the spirit God gave us does not make us timid, but gives us power, love, and self-discipline. I pray that you would act out of love, as this verse says, that you would champion the underdog, the ignored, the outcast, and the oppressed. God has given you strength, passion, and a beautiful ability to speak up and out. I look forward to seeing how you use this in an uncertain world. I am proud of you, and I bless you. 2 Timothy 2:22. Flee the evil desires of youth and pursue righteousness, faith, love, and peace, along with those who call on the Lord out of a pure heart. David, I chose this verse for you because I have already seen you do this. Your maturity this year was striking. The stress and craziness of 2020 hit early for you. I'd say clear back in 2019. Yet I saw you take a breath, reach for your faith, and keep moving. You kept your friends and family close, but most of all, you trusted in the Lord. Overnight, you were a strong, capable man pursuing righteousness, faith, love, and peace. Instead of choosing fear, doubt, and despair, you chose to trust God's goodness and faithfulness. Instead of inaction, you chose to act and continue a path for yourself of life and hope. And then everything got better. Unfortunately, that's not true. Things for all of us continue to get more stressful. As it felt like the world was falling apart, you suffered like the rest of us. Yet in the midst of this, you stayed faithful. You continued to serve your family and friends and maintained your goals. It has been a privilege to watch you go from being a youth to a man of God. Thanks for sharing your journey with us. I am proud of you and I bless you.
Andrew David Yarger. My image of you in the past 4 years is one that has moved from squirrely, jokester, daydreamer, to responsible, reliable, and honorable. Someone of quiet influence. A quiet influence that has been essential to leadership in our homeroom, on campus, and in our sports teams. But sometimes it's hard, Andrew, to see what is lying beneath that calm. Psalm 118:5, 6. I called on the Lord in distress. The Lord answered me and set me in a broad place. The Lord is on my side. I will not fear. What can man do to me? In our moments of despair, we have been given the privilege to cry out to God, to open up and express our distress. This year, many of your expectations were not met, but yet he has already begun to set you in a broad place, an open place, a place for you to grow in your talents and your faith. This is my prayer. May you grow your voice to support your quiet leadership, a voice that allows you to express your thoughts, your questions, your joys, your determination, and your doubts. A voice driven by the strength of Christ, a voice with no fear for what can man do to you. God is in your corner, and for what it's worth, so am I. Love you. Hey, Jinsu Kim, your change from freshman year to senior was quite dramatic. It was a bit bumpy ride at the beginning, but somewhere around your sophomore year, you began to settle down, push yourself in your studies, and start to be intentional in your relationship with Christ. You started to seek truth. Matthew 28:19-20. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. Jesus spoke these words to his disciples after spending 3 years with them, leading by example. Even after 3 years, they struggled with doubts, but he let them know that he was with them and they were ready. Jinsu, you are ready to do his work. You took full advantage of what Desert Christian had to offer and I thank you for that. Remember that you are a disciple of Christ and that your actions and intentions must be grounded in his teaching. Certainly you will have doubts, but if you remain a seeker of truth, your life will be a beautiful influence on others. I know it has been on me. It has been an honor to be your teacher.
Loud and clear. This is the class that you all fear. Freshman year.
Test, test. All right, there we go. We all ready? All right. Hey, it's that time. Let's have the first row stand up. Get ready to go. It's been about a month in waiting, but we're finally ready to do this. So exciting. All right, let's get it going. Avery John Michael Allday. Gracelyn Kate Anderson. Yutong Chen. Justin Chung. Ryan Nicholas James Copley. Tao Hi Tang Dong. Matthew Randy Espenson. David Kirkpatrick Fagan. Zewan Gao. And even though he's not here, Corbin Michael Gonzalez. Greta Lauren Haas. Emily Madison Harless. Keenan Anthony Harmon. Adam Cole Haynes. Autumn Faith Hopkins. Jack Richard Hutton. Jinsu Kim. Holly Alexis Kishbaugh. Dan Ariel Marquez. Sydney Grace Martin. Ashlyn May McHaney. Zachary Michael McHolm. Dumercy Ikingi Munjambere. Anna Kaylee Murray. Jaslyn Amber Smith. Landon Michael Snyder. Peter Wesley Sommets. Cody Lee Norad Stember. Sarah Ashley Swinney. Lillian Antonia Taze. David Abraham Terrazon. Amelia Grace Thorson. Hannah Sydney Trainer. Alexandra Elizabeth Tucker. Andrew David Yarger. Save the best for last. Henry Thomas William Yates.
Hello, everyone.
I'm Jinsu.
All right. So I was going to make this short, but, well, actually, I'm required to make this short. But now that I have my mask off and can breathe, I think I'm going to take my time. So I apologize in advance if I go over time. I'm sorry. Well, here we are. Childhood is over. Adulthood begins. Did you guys hear that? Childhood is over. Adulthood begins. How should we respond to the blessing and challenge? How should we respond as Christians to the blessing and the challenge that is ahead of us? Be firm with your faith. As a class, we've all learned Colossians 2:8, which says, "See to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends on human tradition and the basic principles of this world rather than on Christ." We're starting a new chapter of our lives in a totally different environment and within a new community. As Christians, we should follow the principles of the Bible and walk with God. Do not be deceived. Be firm with your faith. Consider your relationships, any and all relationships that we make in our lives are there for a reason. God has designed us to have relationships with others, so take care of your relationships and value your time with others. Build your relationships with people who are going to make your faith, who are going to strengthen your faith. Be wise with your decisions. There are many more decisions to come down the road. As we get older, we face more decisions to make, and some of the decisions we're going to make are going to be difficult. I hope you make your decisions based on the wisdom of God. Pray to God and seek from the wise. If you be firm with your faith, consider your relationships, and be wise with your decisions, I believe that you can be the light of this world and make a difference in this world for the glory of God. This may sound overwhelming, but even if you fail, God is going to guide us through forgiveness if you repent. So accept the consequences, learn from your mistakes, and trust God, who is going to fill you with his goodness. Please join me in prayer. Dear Lord, I thank you for bringing me to this community and blessing me with this school and the relationships that I have made in it. Thank you for getting us through high school and providing for us. Thank you for the teachers, administrators, parents, host parents, and friends. I pray that you will help us to be strong in our faith, careful with our relationships, and wise with our decisions. Help us to influence, impact, and change people's lives for the better. From the gifts and talents that are given by you for each one of us, God, help us to determine your calling. You know us better than anyone. Help us through this next chapter of our lives. We love you. Amen. Congratulations, fellow classmates. We did it.
Luke, I am your father. He's headed. All right, I'm taking it off.
I love that. I have to admit, that was not completely unexpected, that theme. But I will tell you, that is probably my favorite. It's our fourth, when we started together, this class and me started this. This is my fourth year also, and that's my favorite. Sorry if there's any former classes watching this. That's too bad. Suck it up. In just a moment, I am going to present to you the class of 2020. And after they recess through the back and out or into our, through our gym lobby out into the outdoors, you're encouraged to use one of the three exits. We've got the main exit that you came in. There's an exit back here. And also, if you want to use the exit here and then hang a quick left and go down the athletics hall just to be thoughtful for physical distance. And now, in accordance with the academic guidelines and policies set forth by the Board of Trustees of Desert Christian Schools, I proudly present these candidates for graduation. Class, would you stand? You may move your tassels from the right side to the left side. Yes, and turn and face the audience. Ladies and gentlemen, I proudly present to you the Desert Christian High School graduating class of 2020. Follow your leads.